guiding our paths. And so it's really important, it's certainly in African traditions, to honor those that are unseen, but yet in our presence. And so this ritual is basically just to pour libations for our ancestors. And our ancestors, you know, those that we knew, those that we didn't know. And you'll see two dolls on the altar. These two dolls are called Abayome dolls. And these are for the ancestors who came across on the Middle Passage and had to create a way of comforting their children on the ships. And so these dolls are for them. So these are the more ancient ancestors. So they're representative of that. The rest of the altar shows immediate family. These are my grandparents and my uncle. So Omari's my paternal grandparents. And uncle and Omari's great grandparents. These are my grandparents and all their children. Reverend and Mrs. Mummy, right here, the tallest one in the group. So those are all her sisters and one of her, well, most of them, she had one sister and one brother and not represented. But Uncle Ali and Auntie Merlin, we know you're here. And then these are my parents. This is my father, George Johnson, and my mom, Lino Johnson. And then these are Omari's paternal grandparents, Mary Booker and Monroe Booker. And Monroe Booker. And these are my daughter, Damali, and my brother, Cameron. So those are the ancestors that we have represented, and their spirit, of course, Damali is in the show, and she's pretty much in everything Omari does. So I would just like to say, you know, thank you all for being here for this, to celebrate this very sacred moment with us. And I will start by asking Omari to name the ancestors that have, that he, those are on the altar, and anyone else he feels have been instrumental in bringing him to this point. And when he says all the names, we will all say Ashe, and I will pour some vodka. We need to have some real spirits. So I'll pour some vodka into a cup. I won't pour it on the ground. Okay? And when he's done, I will also light a candle. And then we will open it up to any of you who have an ancestor that you want to just bring into this moment. Okay? So you will say their name. I will pour some vodka. And I will light a candle for them. Okay?
Okay. Lenore Franga Johnson. Damali Ayanna Booker. Grandmom and Granddaddy. Mary Monroe Booker. Uncle Ken Kendrick Johnson. Kendrick Snake Johnson.
George
Johnson, Yusef Harris, Brother Kwame Lillard, Cody Minitree, Uncle Jimmy, James Baldwin, Maya Angelou, Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, and a host of others that I know I have left out and remain unnamed, and anyone that you all can fill in, please. Welcome to now.
Okay. Good morning. My name is.
Yeah, that's kind of my special.
My name is called so many things.
sincere. We invite you to call the name of any ancestor that you like.
Monroe Pettis.
Rena and John Karifa Smart. John Karifa Smart Jr.
Victor Frankl, the writer of Man's Search for Meaning.
Ashe.
Bell Hooks.
Ashe.
Celebrate with me. You know, I remember when I was years ago, probably early 20s, I would hear about people getting off of parole and they'd throw a barbecue or have people over, and I was like, what are you celebrating for? You got in trouble, you're supposed to, you know, like, what's the celebration? And now I have a different understanding of what coming to the end of that journey means now that I've walked the road myself. And so I'm really grateful for everyone in this room, and I just want to share a couple of things about the exhibit and about some of the people that you see in the exhibit. I will start with Granger, since Granger is who I looked at first. And I don't think that it can be stated enough how much love Granger gave me. I think I have a little token of something that everyone in the room, or that some of the people in the room have given me, but the thing that Granger gave me was a lot of love. And what that love turned into was a lot of self-confidence. I think when somebody believes you can do anything in the world, then you believe you can do anything in the world. And my entire life, I had that person that was right next to me, kind of right over me, that, you know, I slept in her bed when I was scared, all of the things. And she loved me to the point that I never thought that I was less than anything. I always felt like I had a fighting shot because of the way that she felt about me. And I echo the same thing for my mom and the same thing for my sister and my dad. But Granger was the first and the most consistent. And right up until, you know, the trouble that I got into, she never saw me any differently. So the thing that she gave me was love. I'm gonna go to my mom next. I think the thing that my mom gave me, also love, also self-confidence. Whenever I was in school and I would say, you know, I mean, everybody gets to do this, she would always say, not everybody. And at the time, I thought that was her just being a stickler and mean and strict and all that stuff. But as I got to be older, I realized, no, you're not everybody. And she was telling me you're exceptional and that you can act exceptionally and believe you're exceptional. And that's the big thing that my mom gave me. She also gave me a watch. Anyone that knows me knows that I'm a big fan of watches. And my mom's not a material giver. She gives you things you need and love and energy and wisdom. But she actually did give me a watch for my birthday because I love watches. So that's kind of what I have here as one of the things my mom gave me. Also wisdom and spirituality. I think my sense of spirituality comes directly from my mom and also my dad. The thing that my dad gave me was this Bible when I was 16 years old. And if you look at it, you would think that I've been reading it. That are in this Bible that my dad gave me when I was 16. The same year that Jay-Z's Reasonable Doubt came out, I think a lot of my, I think as well as confidence, entrepreneurship, business practices, and just belief in yourself, I think Jay-Z has an incredible belief in what he can do regardless of what anyone else is doing. He has an incredible sense of timing and not letting the world rush your process. And I think the show is an example of, you know, doing things in the time that makes sense. Daddy, I appreciate this Bible. Jay, I appreciate Reasonable Doubt all the way up to 444. Randy, I tell you, I wish I could give you all the Randyisms. One of them is, it's not about the money, it's about the money. So this is a money clip. On one side it is a Studio Harlem Museum. The other side is a bag ticket to LA. So when I started going out to LA and realized that I wanted to make some sort of life there, I kept that there. I have not been to the Studio Museum of Harlem yet, but it's in there, and that probably means that I'll be there sooner or later. But yeah, Randy has been incredibly helpful throughout. It seems like my whole life. I mean, now it's about the past 20 years or so. Initially working at Sunset Grill, writing letters to the parole board, you know. However many times you fired me, you hired me one more time. So if I was fired twice, I was hired three times.
You did get the money.
And when I finally left Mid Midtown Cafe to start a career in art and go work for Nate Harris, who also loved the early open woodcuts. Randy gave me this money clip and said, go put some money in it. So that's the thing Randy gave me. Damali, she gave me two things. Well, she didn't actually give them to me. I'd say she left them for me. One is Toby, the stuffed animal that Granny gave Damali.
Granny gave her when she was a baby.
When she was, about 1 year old.
Yeah.
Huckleberry, Tara and I do a dog. We got into this one day, and when I tell you, I wept and almost killed it. But I stitched it back together by hand because that's how much Toby means to me. When my mom was looking for, what were you looking for?
I was looking for the password for my
yes.
Wi-Fi.
Yeah, and this was yesterday, right?
Yes.
April 10th.
Yes.
So yeah, yesterday my mom was looking for the passport, the password, and she found something from Damali Booker's creative writing class, April 11th, 1996.
Wow.
So I will read a little bit of it. The bell wakes me at 6 a.m. in the pale spring dawn, with the familiar rumble of murky halls and the smell of bodies. My eyes find solitary light in the distance. Water drops, rain, crystal cold, ascend from the iron basin onto my face. I look at my reflection in the mirror. My face greets the shadow of the rifled guards. They walk us to the workshop. I am the blacksmith of the block. These active hours fly like the sparks in the furnace. I hammer metal skillfully, letting the sweating muscles of my body forge a forgetfulness of this enclosed world, which has become my home. After lunch, we spend time outside, although our outside is encompassed by a great wall. Trees are green beyond the wall, though the narrow openings see leaves swaying back and forth in the sunshine. Most remain on the trees, while some float aimlessly among the millions of wildflowers. At 4 p.m., it's back to the cell. Everything is very mechanical here. One comes quite accustomed to this routine. This is often the time when I write, because this is the time when my heart is at rest. My life is peaceable, and my words, my thoughts, can filter softly through me. I'm taken care of. All my basic needs are met. I am in no way unhappy. I have resigned myself to being completely neutral. We usually get our food on time, and most evenings I read books. I like Jane Austen. Her world agrees with me. It is very elegant, but closed like mine. I fall asleep dreaming of this world, becoming a part of it, at least until 6 a.m. So Damali left this yesterday. We didn't know this existed until yesterday. And Damali A. Booker, creative writing, April 11th, 1996. So.
She was a senior in high school.
Senior
at the time,
high school.
So she had no idea of what was going to happen to Omari in her conscious mind. But it's almost like she traveled to the future.
Yeah.
Wow. And it was just so powerful that I found it yesterday. I mean, I knew that stuff was there, but because it had Damali's name on it, it's, you throw away paper, but that had Damali's name, so I just stuck it. I never read the poem. And I went back to the cupboard three times looking for paper that I thought I might have written the password on. So it was never about the password. It was about me finding that paper.
Reverend, I don't want to misquote you, but that's one of those, that's all they told me to tell you. Tara Booker, we met at Karma. Brian was right next to me. Shocker.
You guys remember it, but we do.
So we met at Karma, which is a club on Broadway. It's now Jason Aldean. We were on the rooftop, and I believe we went to lunch the next Wednesday. And have been together ever since. The piece behind you, that's Tara. I brought this this ring that I fashioned out of my jeans while I was in. So this ring, after I've been in about a year, and I said, if I ever make it out and she sticks around, I'm gonna marry this young lady. I made a ring out of a piece of my denim, and I still have it today, as well as the actual, well, there we go. As well as the actual wedding ring from our wedding where my mom, that's what the photo was from, where my mom
officiated.
So yeah. Tara, thank you so much. It's the journey, I tell you.
What's that?
I don't know. Biscuit, thank you so much. The journey, I tell you. So yeah, but thank you. That's I believe you have something that you want to share, and Reverend has gonna close us out. And thank you all for being here. This is special in a lot of ways for me.
So, I'm grateful.
Reverend Edge Brock, that's right. Now, the trip that I was on when I got this rock, I want to say maybe Fall Creek Falls. I'm not positive. Was it not
that?
Was it Trinidad?
It was
from Trinidad. That's right. So I had Reverend Sanders has an affinity for rocks as do I, and I thought this was just about the coolest thing that I had ever found. And I still think it's really cool. I hadn't seen it in a long time, but I must have been 8. Was that in 88 when I went?
Eight.
So I'd have been 7,
going
on 8. Yeah. And I brought this rock back from my childhood pastor, Reverend Ned, and my current pastor. Yeah. Though he didn't see me that often. but yes, I brought this rock back in 1988. And can you believe that when I asked yesterday, is the rock still around? It's right here today. And so those are the kind of people that walk with you through the entirety of your life. And yeah, that's so much why we're here. And there's a story of some sort for everybody in this room. But yeah, those are just a few I want to make sure that I shared. So yes, thank you for loving me and having this for 30 plus years now. Okay.
Omari. Omari can make almost anything look easy. He exudes ease, peace, calm, content, centered. It's often why people are so drawn to him. His steadiness is grounding. You feel like you're okay, like life's okay, even if he's not okay. These 15 years, beginning with his arrest in 2008, have been anything but easy. We can all imagine the difficulty of the first portion, 3.5 years in prison. I think it's harder to grasp the burden of the last 10 out on parole. Even for me, I think even for him sometimes. That phrase, out on parole, might help tell the story more fully. It's not just out. His sentence wasn't complete on January 30th, 2013. When I picked him up from Charles Bass, he was home, and what a relief it was. But he wasn't done with the Tennessee Department of Corrections having the final say in his life's choices. When I think about these 10 years, I think the heaviest burden was living with the daily reality that at any moment he could be put back in that cell to finish the rest of his sentence on the inside instead of the outside. That threatening prospect often feels like a whim when considering the legal structures in this country. So in order to live in that 10-year liminal space, we both developed the skillful practice of holding that burdensome reality close enough to be cautious, but not so close that we'd be suffocated by it. Because you can only imagine how difficult it might feel for a weight like that to hang over your head every day for 10 years. Today is a celebration of that burden being lifted. Today, the Department of Corrections doesn't have a say. We aren't naive or fantastical about this freedom. We know life will always ask us to carry burdens that each day we must take up our cross. Today, we honor all sides of human life, birth, death, and resurrection. We honor the life of Omari Monroe Booker, born on August 9th, 1980, through the vessels of Sherry Johnson Booker and Cyrus Booker. To life.
To life. To life.
We honor the dying, the sufferings, you've endured over the last 15 years. To death.
To death.
And especially, we honor the resurrection of today, April 11th, 2023. To resurrection.
To resurrection.
I'd like to invite us all to take a deep breath into this newfound space of freedom together.
To freedom.
I'll play a song to kind of give us a moment to meditate and to consider what you might want to offer with your flower to Omari.
Thank you. Yes.
Expressed.
not to go our purpose to do this. What were you wrestling with? How about one? You name it. You know, so, we have a little ministry going at the church that and our oldest son, Timothy, I remember. He knew from day one. He said, that fellow there is going to be great. He's going to do great things. So I always appreciate that. I guess I want to say one thing about the law. And it's amazing. I guess Sherry, yesterday, got a message from me to bring the rock. But it was one of the great to me statements from you. When Mari brought me that rock from Trinidad, in fact, I always thought it was Trinidad.
It was, yeah.
And even as recent as yesterday, I saw something in it that I hadn't seen before. There's actually right in here, there's something that appears to be silver. Mm-hmm. It's always on my desk. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I left it there because I knew, and needless to say, you could tell me a lot of people that I love and admire who I have all kinds of weights and love to. But that rock has always been about you. It's always been visible all these years right there on my desk.
Do you remember? Do you even remember why you wanted to
write
that?
Sherry and I worked together in a context where we served a lot of kids who were required to be in our company.
Yes.
they were mandated by the court to be with us.
Yeah.
And Sherry did
the
educational piece. Yeah, and I did the spirituality piece. And it was great. But let me just tell you, about the rock and why I still carry them all the time in my pocket. And all of my experiences with the people we were working with, I would give them rocks, and we would always use the rock as a focal point in terms of our discussions and life, and just all the things. And for me, the rock was very significant because I, in the midst of a hard time in my life, just picked up some rocks, and I've had rocks in my pocket pretty much ever since. And then I associated it with a passage. I had come to think about it earlier when we were talking about ancestors. And it's a passage that goes like this. It's Galatians 1. Galatians 4. Anyway, it goes like, I want you to remember, my brothers and sisters, what happened to our ancestors. They were all passed through under the cloud and through the Red Sea, that they were blessed to have that which is the bread and the wine, and that which and the water of that which was of the blood, who was the divine. And then it just simply says that you always will have in one way or another things that will provide the substance, what you need to nurture, and what you need to sustain. And then it says, but what happened to them on their journey was that they ran into hard and difficult times. And then it says, but there always was the rock that was with them. And then it says that the rock, and then the faith tradition that I'm the closest to, but I'm very intent about being involved in all faith traditions in every way I can. As a matter of fact, when I was getting ready to put on this robe today, this is very much a part of the tradition of this month. And we're right now, trying to listen. Yeah, get my God's mixed up. But you know what? I always say that they're the same. So I usually call Baba, and I'll talk about the names of the different gods, especially those in the African tradition. But what I'm saying to you is this: whatever your term, there's always rocks. But the reason I stopped using the rocks was I started running into people who would tell me stories that were frightening. And the stories would be things like, oh, remember that? They'd be, you know, in the middle of the street downtown, and fully intoxicated, and, you know, in trouble kind of way. And they come up to me and say, Reverend, I'm so glad to see you. He said, I was doing good for 2.5 years, and then I lost my rock. Mm-hmm. And when I lost my rock, I just began this now. And I realized that the thing, Janet, was getting to be a little cultish. You know? And then I started, you know, doing the rocks in that way. Because the idea is that the rocks are everywhere. And you don't have to have one that came from me or anybody else. It doesn't matter. Understanding is a part of the foundation. Creation is a part of the foundation of everything it is. And we all have the rocks. But I would tell you, in this moment for all of us, we know that this is one of the great statements of the power of the one who is the creator. And the one has always been there to sustain, to provide.